Welcome to Disabilities at Work Radio, where every week we explore issues, ideas, initiatives, and innovations involving the employment of people with disabilities. We feature employers that go beyond compliance in supporting people with disabilities in the workplace and elsewhere. We bring you prominent members of the business community, service providers, government officials, researchers, educators, and people who successfully manage their disability and careers. Join us now for Disabilities at Work.
Hello, I'm Ray Zardetto, and welcome to Disabilities at Work Radio here on the Voice America Business Network. Each week at noon Eastern Time, Disabilities at Work explores issues, ideas, initiatives, and innovations involving the workplace and people with disabilities, and we discuss them with the prominent members of the business, government, and disability communities. Disability at Work Radio is brought to you this week by two distinguished organizations dedicated to improving the lives of the disabled, the Kessler Foundation and the New Jersey Division of Disability Services, and we will talk more about these organizations later in the program. But to begin today's show, I'd like to just take a step back for a moment to the year 1957. It was the year of Sputnik, and Bridge Over the River Kwai was Best Picture, and the most popular TV show in the land was Gunsmoke. Eugene O'Neill's Long Day's Journey and Tonight won the Pulitzer Prize for Drama, and a fellow named Elvis Presley began dominating the music charts. And in that same year, 1957, New York saw the launch of a not-for-profit initiative that today has grown to include over 5,600 people that serve more than 20,000 individuals. It is the YAI Network, and I'm pleased to say that our guest for the first two segments of today's show is the Chief Executive Officer and the President of the YAI Network, Dr. Phillip Levy. So, Dr. Levy, welcome to the show. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Ray. It's my pleasure.
Thank you. Why don't we start right at the beginning? Why don't you tell us what YAI means and what the organization does?
Well, YAI was founded, as you said, 53 years ago as the Young Adult Institute, and today that's a misnomer because we serve people from birth right up through senior citizens. It's a network of seven not-for-profit health and human service agencies. As you mentioned, we serve 20,000 people a day in community-based programs, 450 community-based programs, through a workforce of 5,600 employees. I think what is unique about us as the largest not-for-profit in the country serving this population is that we are so comprehensive in nature and that we do serve people from birth right through their senior years. We are very proud that we are a mission-driven organization, and our mission is typically summarized in what we call the three I's and a P. That's inclusion, independence, individualization, and productivity. We provide every imaginable service from early intervention and preschool services, employment training and placement, family support services, residential services, and we have our own healthcare network, which has been cited by the Surgeon General as a model program for the country. So it's a very diverse and comprehensive organization that tries to really bring hope and opportunity to the lives of people with disabilities and their families.
I'm wondering why you think your organization has grown to the size that it has, given the scope of it today.
Well, I think that our success is a product of many things. One is that there was an opportunity in the early 1970s for there to be an alternative approach to working with people with developmental disabilities to what was then the accepted norm, which was institutionalization. And why I had never run an institutional program, we always believed in community-based services. And we were able to take our mission, and we're a very mission-driven organization, and take our mission and apply it to the needs that were very present at that time. Some people might still remember an institution called Willowbrook and something called the Willowbrook Decree. And we were the first people to take people out of Willowbrook and place them in the community. And we also placed the last people who left the institution in the community.
To stay on the Willowbrook thing for a moment, because I don't know if many of our listeners go back to remember that. Why don't you explain a little bit about what happened there and how that got to be such a seminal moment, and what happened dealing with people with disabilities?
Sure. Willowbrook was an institution on Staten Island. In those days, parents didn't realize that there was an alternative, and in fact, there really were few alternatives to placing your child with a developmental disability, either in an institution or keeping them pretty much locked up at home. And Robert Wagner, as the mayor in those days early on, and then Robert Kennedy and others took an interest in this, and then Geraldo Rivera went in there with a camera, and he showed the deplorable conditions of warehousing people with developmental disabilities. And I think what happened is, the world was shocked by this, and parents brought a lawsuit, and the judiciary branch of government decided that this was unacceptable, and there was something called the Willowbrook Decree, in which the governor, then Governor Carey, agreed with the judiciary to have a plan where people would be deinstitutionalized, and a system of community-based care was created as a result. And we were at the forefront of doing that. And I think much of our success was that we saw this opportunity, and it was very consistent with our belief system of inclusion. It was very consistent with our mission and our philosophy. And we were able to develop a comprehensive-based system where people would be deinstitutionalized, as well as people who were living in the community would never have to be institutionalized.
Mm-hmm.
And so we created a match between those two groups of people and created new programs.
I'd like you to describe or talk in a little bit more detail what you mean when you say that you're a mission-driven organization at this point. What exactly does that mean?
Well, I think that no matter what you do and no matter how much you grow, it is important to always be very true to your values and your mission. Our mission is to build brighter futures for people with disabilities by looking at each person as an individual first and foremost. Not having the individual fit the program, but having the program fit the needs of the individual and respond to that. The second is that we believe very strongly in helping each and every person, no matter what their level of disability, to be as self-reliant and as independent as possible. And the third is that we believe that people with this developmental disability should be integrated, and we call that inclusion, integrated into the all aspects of society, whether it be social aspects, religious aspects, educational aspects, the world of work, where people live, that they should always be a part of the community rather than kept apart from. And then finally, the P and the three I's and a P stand for productivity, and that is that whatever someone is engaged in, whether it's a job, whether it's a volunteer opportunity, whether it's a program because they are multiply disabled that they need that's very specialized, that it is always very productive, and we are always actualizing the individual's potential for growth. And that's what I mean by mission-driven. I think that another aspect of why we've been so successful, and this is very critical, is partnerships. You cannot do what we've been able to do and to grow as dramatically as we have without partnerships with government, with families, with the individuals we serve, with corporate America, with our neighbors right in the community, so that people feel a sense of commitment, that same sense of commitment that we have and that same sense of pride. And then finally, I think another reason for our success has been our commitment to what we call the pursuit of excellence. We do not believe in trying to do a good job or a very good job. We strive to always do an excellent job. and to perform at the highest level possible. And finally, we do not believe that our people should merely be taken care of. We believe that they should be habilitated and that they should learn to better take care of themselves. So there's a philosophy, a value system, and a mission that drives the organization. And I think by staying true to that mission, despite all of our growth, that has really facilitated that growth. And if I was going to add one other thing, it would be that we are rather unique in that we have an incredible commitment to our staff. We say that we take care of the people who take care of the people. And we're very proud of the fact that Cranes recognized us as the number one not-for-profit. We've been recognized as the best large company to work for in New York State. We've been recognized by the American Psychological Association, all for the environment we create for our workforce and how we treat them. And I think that's a critical aspect because ultimately, in that moment when the person with a disability has a need, it's the direct service professional who works with that person. And if we have educated that person properly, if we have nurtured their development, if we've treated them with dignity and respect, then they treat the individual with a disability in the same manner. And that, I think, is critical to our success.
And you're based in New York City, correct?
Well, our headquarters are in New York City. We provide services and supports throughout the country and most recently throughout the world.
Right. As a matter of fact, I do want to get to that in our next segment because I think
but we provide services right now throughout the boroughs, throughout Nassau and Suffolk, Westchester, Rockland, going upstate, New Jersey, Puerto Rico, U.S. Virgin Islands, and we provide training and educational materials in all 50 states.
Okay, and that's the point I wanted to make sure we're sure everybody understood. So we have to take a break, and when we come back, more with Dr. Phillip Levy of the YAI Network, including we're going to branch out into a fascinating discussion, I think, about how YAI is spreading its influence and its good work overseas, no longer just limiting it here to the United States. So stay with us. More to come. I'm Ray Zardetto, and this is Disabilities at Work Radio.
When it comes to business, you'll find the experts here. Voice America Business Network. Disabilities at Work encourages people with disabilities, their families, and their supporters to patronize businesses that have earned the right to display the Disabilities at Work logo on wall plaques, window decals, or websites. By some estimates, people with disabilities control hundreds of millions of dollars in disposable income. They can use that spending power to send a message to corporate America, become a Disabilities at Work business, or a registered agency with the power to endorse supportive businesses at the Disabilities at Work website, www.disabilitiesatwork.org.
We hear it and read about it every day in the news.
Stock prices plunging, home prices receding, and unemployment rising to levels not seen since the Great Depression.
How can you preserve and increase your wealth in this kind of economy? Tune in to Turning Hard Times into Good Times with host Jay Taylor. Jay will explain the decline of our monetary system and the economy and will give you winning investment ideas and the tools to protect and increase your wealth. Turning Hard Times into Good Times with Jay Taylor can be heard Tuesdays at 3 p.m. Eastern Time, noon Pacific Time on the Voice America Business Channel.
When it comes to business, you'll find the experts here. Voice America Business Network.
You are listening to Disabilities at Work Radio. We welcome questions and comments from our listening audience, which you can send to us on Twitter at Disabilities At or on our Facebook site, Disabilities at Work. Also, visit disabilitiesatwork.org. Welcome back.
And welcome back to Disabilities at Work Radio here on Voice America's Business Network. This week's show, again, is brought to you by the Kessler Foundation and the State of New Jersey's Division of Disability Services. I'm Ray Zardetto, and I'm speaking today with Dr. Phillip Levy, the Chief Executive Officer and President of the YAI Network. And we spent the first segment of our program talking a lot about what YAI does here in the United States, but Recently, YAI signed an agreement, a very interesting and unique one, with the Kingdom of Jordan, and I'll let Dr. Levy explain a little bit about what's happening there.
Well, we're very, very excited about this. For the past more than 25 years, we have conducted an international conference for this field, and we've collaborated as a result with sharing information throughout the world. And recently, we were approached by His Royal Highness Prince Ra'ad to see how we could help them. And we signed an agreement with the Kingdom of Jordan where we will assess their service system for people with developmental disabilities, and we will help them make decisions about how they will design their system going forward. As a result of that, an organization in Saudi Arabia heard about what we were doing and asked us if we would assist them. And we are going to be working with an organization called ONISA, which is Association for Development and Human Services in Saudi Arabia, to help them develop improved service system for people with developmental disabilities. We're also working with many other countries around the world through our website and through utilization of technology to share information. And this year, our conference, which will take place May 2nd to 5th at the New York Hilton, we'll have people from all over the world attending so that we can share our information and help people everywhere to you know, actualize their potential.
Mm-hmm. I'm just curious if you know how many U.S.-based organizations that help people with disabilities like this spread out or branch out internationally like yours has?
I think very few.
Yeah.
And I think very few even branch out, you know, throughout our country. Most stay in one particular area, and most serve one particular age group. And I think what, you know, differentiates us and distinguishes us is that we are able to serve people from birth through their senior citizens in so many different locations, and to maintain our quality and our value system while doing that. And that is really critical.
Okay. We're going to talk more about the agreement that YAI has signed with the Kingdom of Jordan in the next segment with some of Dr. Levy's colleagues. But before we go on to another topic, I don't know, Phil, if you can't even answer this question, but I'm just curious, based on the fact you have branched out globally like this, or at least to other parts of the globe, where do you think the U.S. falls in its treatment of people with disabilities vis-a-vis the rest of the world?
Well, I think it's a great question. The U.S. is a huge country, and I think we have been a leader in many ways in this field in New York State because of the Willowbrook Decree and because of the commitment that has been made. Certain other states have performed at a similar level. Others have not. There are lawsuits in many other states because they still operate an institutional-based system. So as a country, it is harder to answer that. As a state, New York is really at the forefront. And as an organization, we're very proud of the fact that we've been able to take our expertise and to apply it to so many other states throughout the country, either in the development of actual services or in the sharing of information.
Okay. And as long as we're back talking about the U.S., let's focus domestically again for some more of the conversation. It's been 20 years now, a little bit more, since the Americans with Disability Act was signed into law. I assume you would think that was a significant step in the treatment and the attitude of dealing with people with disabilities. Now, a little more than 20 years later, how would you evaluate the effectiveness of that act? And then B, what do you think needs to happen now, you know, the next major things that have to happen in addition to that?
Well, I think, you know, the ADD has been critical in not only changing expectations that people have for people with disabilities, as well as families have in terms of services for their children. But most importantly, I think what it has helped to do also is to change attitudes. And in order to change a system, you have to begin by changing attitudes. A very important part of that is shows like the one you're doing and some of the other things that we have done over the years, where we work very, very hard at changing the attitudes of people as it relates to people with developmental disabilities, so as to view them as you would any other person, a person who wants social contact, who strives to want productive activity in their life, who wants to be a part of their community and their family. And as we change those attitudes, a great deal more follows. One of the ways we've been able to do that is through our job training and placement programs and our business advisory council that we have formed under the leadership of Pfizer. We're very, very proud of the fact that we are at a time where the economy is so challenged, and it certainly is, when unemployment is so high, and it's even higher for people with disabilities, obviously, that we've still been able to work with corporations and create job opportunities. Because once you can take a person and help them to become a taxpayer rather than a recipient of government funding, then you are ultimately changing not only attitudes but the entire system. And that has been really effective. But there are many challenges, and they exist at a very high level right now, some of which are related to the economy, some of which, you know, at a time when the economy is challenged, sometimes people regress in their views of standards and how people of all different challenges should be treated. And we have to be very careful in terms of that, especially at a time when there is more demand than ever for services from YI and other, you know, organizations like ours. You know, with autism on the rise, you know, with a wonderful aspect of what we've been able to do is because we provide medical care, and we'll be helping, you know, Jordan and Saudi Arabia in terms of that. Our medical care has helped people to live much longer in their lives, people with developmental disabilities. Today, their lifespan is 20 years longer than it was just 20 years ago. And their lifespan is pretty typical today of the general population. But what happens is now you have aging issues with people with developmental disabilities. And how do you meet their growing medical needs, as well as their other needs, you know, in terms of accessibility? So I think, you know, as we think about all that we've accomplished, what we have to look at and say that, yes, we were part of a social revolution. Yes, we were part of a social revolution. Yes, we were